The dawn of civilization. Primitive. Dangerous. Exciting. The handwriting is on the wall. If the human race is ever going to amount to anything, it needs
the most civilized caveman I have ever seen.
Look, he's come out of his cave.
Counting down. Hey everyone, this is James from Cave Dweller Music. I am here with another Cave Dweller admin, rather Dr. Yasman. He is a Twitch streamer. You may have seen his stuff, but he's also one of the admins for our site. Great writer, great editor. And we are joined today by our guest, Alex from Mothman and the Thunderbirds, who's been a longtime friend of Cave Dweller, and we're happy to have him on the show.
Thanks, guys. Happy to be here.
Welcome.
Thanks for coming. Yari, I know that you've been a really big fan of this project for a super long time. You must be pretty stoked that the new album's coming out.
Very, very. I love this. Whoops. What's going on with my... Sorry.
It's too stoked.
I love this band. I love this band.
Thank you.
And I... You know, it was you that originally sent me... That originally sent me Into the Hollow, which came out a couple of years ago. And I was immediately grabbed by it. And... here we are with Portal Hopper coming out pretty soon, and it's a hell of an album. So if you've never heard Mothman and the Thunderbirds before, Alex here, would you like to introduce the band a bit?
Yeah, sure. Hi. So Mothman and the Thunderbirds, I started the band, I guess, back in 2020 during when COVID kicked off. I recorded the song Nomad, released that. So it's kind of like, it started as like a sludge stoner metal project with a bit of prog. That's what you get on like the first album, the debut album. And then it kind of, had a few like EP releases in between. And now we're coming up on this second album. And it's much more like in the press materials, I'm calling it dream metal, which, I hope people don't get mad at me for making up another obscure genre tag. But it's a lot more, I amped up the prog on this album. There's still some like sludgy elements to it, especially in, like the guitars and some of the riffs, but it's a lot more proggy with like psychedelic atmosphere and a lot of like hard rock hooks and stuff. So it's proggy, but it's like the songs never go over like 3 or 4 minutes. So it kind of does a bunch of neat stuff within a tight time frame. Hopefully it's catchy and hopefully it's fun. That's kind of what I'm aiming for.
That's true. I mean, it definitely has, the sound has evolved. Like, I quite liked Into the Hollow, but it was noticeably like a bit more sludgy, I'd say. And whereas this, I can definitely see those like prog elements, especially with some of the keyboard stuff that you've got in there. Like, you listen to tracks like Polygon or Polywog. I was listening to that the other day and Fractals, of course, both a lot more. You can definitely notice that prog, I think, front and center in tracks like those, in those tracks.
Yeah. Sorry.
I was just going to ask, Yari, is Polygon or Polywog the second track? That is right.
Yeah.
That's the second
track. That one's right. I also thought the same thing about that one when I heard it.
Yeah. So that one has like, I didn't count, but it's like 50 layers of just like synths and guitars, and there's one bass, one drum programmed, and then I do like the verse vocals, and the chorus has like maybe like 6 or 8 different vocals on it. So there's a ton layered in there.
I love that layering too. I love that sound of like a. It's something that I'm actually like currently kind of really big on as well. So it comes out at the perfect time for me to hype about it, because I really love that like richly layered prog sound, like the Deer Hunter does that really well, and you've kind of like their last album, Antimai, was my favorite album of the year when I listened to it when it came out, and it kind of, they did that really well in that album, and you've kind of done it pretty well here too, the layering. So
nice I'll have to check that out. I don't it sounds good like album. It'd be up my alley.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, definitely. So for anyone who doesn't know the project, do you want to tell people a little bit about the inspiration behind the name Mothman and the Thunderbirds?
Yeah, sure. So I think I've said this before, but like one of the hardest parts about starting a band is coming up with a good band name, because all the good ones have like already been taken. So it's really hard to like, don't know, I've been in bands in the past and I've just never been happy with the name. So when I was writing songs for this project, I was like, I need something fun and catchy and something that, you know, I'm going to not like look back on in 2 weeks and be like, why the hell did I name it this? And, you know, Mothman and the Thunderbirds is still like goofy, campy, but I don't know. It works for what the project is. So pretty much how I came up with the name, you know, over like back in 2020 when I first started this, like I was watching Ancient Aliens with my wife and, you know, just as like a COVID binge, like, I don't know, just a fun, dumb, good, you know, TV show to watch.
Yeah.
And then they were talking about like flying humanoids on one episode, and they were in one of the, you know, guys was saying like, you know, Mothman and the Thunderbirds are two examples of blah blah blah. And then I heard those two words in a sentence together. I was like, oh shit, that's a pretty good band name, and I that stuck with me. So I went with it ever since.
It's a classic way to learn that to come across the name of something that you're waiting, you're kind of thinking about the name. It's like that literally is the same way that the game series Doom got its name, because John Romero was watching a movie, what was it was an old Tom Cruise movie about a pool player, The Color of Money, I think it was. And
oh, that's a great movie.
It is a really good movie. And there's a scene in it where he has his pool cue and he brings it in, and it's like his badass custom pool cue. And he brings it to the table and somebody says to him, somebody like John Romero says, he was sitting on the couch watching this movie late at night, and Tom Cruise brings his pool cue in and plops it down on the table, and somebody goes to him, hey man, what's in the cue? And Tom Cruise goes, Doom. And then John Romero was sitting there like, whoa, that's what I have to call it.
Yeah.
You had a John Romero moment.
Right. Yeah. It's great when someone on TV can do the work for you, right?
That's right.
So have you met any cryptids in real life?
No, unfortunately have not. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I should change my answer and say yes and come up with some elaborate tale. But no, it's one of those things that's always like fascinated me. I mean, I've always been obsessed with like nature and animals and things like that. And then, you know, cryptids just feel like, you know, a sort of mythological tack on to that love. So it's kind of, I don't know. I've been obsessed, but I can't say I've seen one. What's that?
We've talked about this. I've talked to you about this a little bit before, but what's the local cryptids in your area, if there are any?
Yeah, around Philly, there's not like too many big ones. There are like more like, I guess, like fabled places. Like there's a place outside of Philly called Satanville that, you know, apparently like the trees are all crooked, and if you drive through at night, like you hear voices or you get chased down by, you know, strange people or something like that. But as far as like Pennsylvania cryptids go, I think what you're referring to is the one I was talking about, the squonk. Which is so for people who don't know what the squonk is, I mean, definitely Google it, but it is basically it's like a little pig like creature that with like warts all over its body, hideous looking thing, and it just it cries and cries all day because it just sees its reflection, you know, when it's drinking water or whatever, and just is so upset with how ugly it is. And you know, whatever 19th century, 18th century naturalists were wandering through the area said they like captured this creature, but then when they opened up their sack to see the creature, like it had dissolved to a pool of tears. So that's the whole story behind the squonk, basically. If, you know, cryptids usually think of some kind of like alien or some kind of fearsome, you know, Yeti, Bigfoot, Loch Ness monster kind of thing, but squonk's just kind of a sad little dude and is just, you know, living a little miserable life, but cute little dude. And I don't know. I found out about him. I think saw someone on like Twitter tweet about it. I was like, great, cool. This is another cryptid I could look into and use for this project. So I have on Into the Hollow, I have a song called Squonk, which is just me like doing vocal harmonies because it's like one of my favorite things to do when I'm recording vocals. And then on this new album, Portal Hopper, I have a song called Squonk Kingdom. And basically that's, I don't know. I want to kind of try to set a thing, if I can, each album do a song about a squonk, just because, I don't know. Pennsylvania's maybe most famous cryptid, and if you want to call it famous, but I don't know. They're just fun little creatures. And so this track on the new album, it's like, you know, it's halfway through the album. It kind of fits in with the story where the Portal Hopper like finds this kingdom where the squonks have all moved, and they have like this rocket ship that can get him to the next destination he needs to be at. So I threw in my own little fiction there, but it's a
there's an amazing cryptid from somewhere where James went to recently, but we can circle back to that because I want to ask you about Portal Hopper a bit more.
One question before we move on. I just want to say that you should do like do it as like a 70s prog rock type style of the track continuing across each album with the squonk and call it like Squonks Lament Part 1 through 3 or something.
Yeah. so you know,
like,
what's funny?
In a style where there's like Metropolis Part 1 and then Metropolis Part 2 is the album later on. Like,
yeah.
You know what's funny about you bringing up 70s prog is that Genesis, like right after Peter Gabriel left the band, they do have a song called Squonk.
Yeah.
And, really? I didn't actually know that. It's really good. Yeah. I didn't know it until after I released the song Squonk, and I was like, I should look up if anyone else had ever done this Squonk song. And then, you know, only one of my favorite prog bands had done it, and I had no
just
idea.
Genesis.
So.
I love that it's just you and Genesis, which is an amazing little group of bands.
Yeah, at least those are the notable ones, right? But it's a good song. And I was, over the winter, I was, you know, just going to grab groceries, and on my way out in the parking lot, there was just this like 6-year-old dude, like 60-year-old. I realize it sounded like I said 6, but no, 6-year-old dude, you know, bald, rocking the mustache, just jamming Squonk out of his pickup truck, just blasting it in the parking lot. And I was just like, hell yeah, dude, that that rocks. So people know the Squonks are out there.
That is cool.
People fear the Squonks.
have you heard of a band from Pennsylvania called Almost Honest?
I have, yeah. I think we're like mutuals on some of the like Twitter and stuff like that. But they're pretty cool. I still
folklore and cryptid based stuff from Pennsylvania and Pennsylvania Dutch legend.
Interesting.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah, I know like they had a whole concept with their new album and all that. But they've done more of their cryptid research than I have, it seems like, because my problem is I'm more obsessed with real animals, so like I'll start looking into cryptids and then I'll just be like, well, I'm on a Wikipedia rabbit hole, let's see what lived, you know, where I'm at like 2 million years ago or something like that. Like, I don't know, like I started this with a strong
paleontology rabbit hole.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Those guys are cool. Almost Honest, they're good stuff.
Oh yeah, they actually came out a podcast a while back.
Oh, nice.
What made you, you talked about before, kind of going in more of a proggy direction for this album. What made you want to do that?
Yeah, a couple of things. I mean, one, you know, I kind of just write whatever, and then I have a bunch of songs and I'm like, okay, how do they fit, you know, There was a lot of going through that with this album to make sure like the concept all flowed and whatnot. Like, it wasn't just a mishmash of songs, but basically, like, you know, I wrote these kind of more melodic proggier riffs, but then also just with vocals, like I've been practicing a lot since the debut. Like, I think I did a decent job on the debut, but it's not where I wanted it to be at. So I've really practiced singing a lot and just haven't practiced, I don't know. I'm just not as into doing like the harsh kind of scream growl vocals as much as I was when I was first doing this project. So I kind of gravitated towards stuff that would lend itself better to having like soaring cleans and vocal harmonies and stuff. So that's really kind of how I came to this point.
And you've got more of a, you've got more sort of outside instrumental involvement this time, right? Like, you've got Yegor and.
Yeah, so a little bit. Most of it is like all played by me. The drums are programmed. You know, sorry to disappoint anyone on that front. One day I'll get a real drummer. But I play, you know, most of the instruments and do most of the singing. I did have guests come in to do the guitar solos though. So Fractals, my producer Yegor, he does the solo there, and I just said, you know, it's in this key. You know, I trust you. Just do something cool and. He can get back with something super cool. So I was very, very happy with that. And then my brother, Sam, he's my older brother. He's a guitar player too. He did 2 solos on this album. So he did Escape from Flatwoods, which is like, I think it's like the 8th track. And it's like, I call it Kerry King Crimson because he kind of goes, you know, he does like Kerry King thing, but there's a lot of weird like tritones and just weird tonality in it that reminds me of King Crimson. So that one's cool. And then he does on the song So Long, or So Long parentheses Portal Hopper, because I had to make all these titles a little annoying and confusing. Yeah. But he does a solo for that. And for that, he did this kind of like, it's almost like 90s 8-bit video game kind of classical tapping thing that's just like insane. Like listening to both those solos, you couldn't even tell it's the same guitar player, but they both sound like they both fit the songs perfectly and they sound really sick. So I was happy to have him back. And he appeared on Into the Hollow too. He did the solo for Garth and Riders, which is also a pretty cool solo, a lot more standard like heavy metal kind of solo, but he crushed that too. So I don't know, I like writing all this stuff. I'm not the most technically savvy guitar soloist in the world, so if I can open that up to a guest spot, I think that's always fun. Vocals, I try to keep it mostly to myself just to be selfish or whatever, but I do have my friend Joe Sobieski. He's been on a lot of the previous releases. He sings on Liminal Space Time Continuum, like I said again with the lengthy song titles, and he sings on Somewhere in Time, the like the bouncy folk song of the album.
Yeah.
And then he also does a bit of, he wrote part of the vocal melody to Fractals and to Liminal Space Time Continuum. Yeah. And then he also does a bit of like low backing vocals on Fractals, but you might not even be able to hear it because there's like 20 million layers in that one. But it supports the song. And yeah, I like working with him. Previously he'd sang on the verses for Gazer and for the All-Star cover.
Gazer was good.
Yeah, Gazer. It's still one of my favorite. Maybe pre Portal Hopper, right? Because I have to pretend like this album is the best one, like every band does. I mean, I'm not even pretending. I think this is the best of all the Mothman releases. But before that, Gazer is probably my favorite of all the Mothman stuff I've done. So, really glad to have him sing on that one. And then he sang on Cloud Giant from the debut album too.
I would agree too. Like I loved Into the Hollow, James can vouch for that. I really did love that album, but I do think this is a better album listening
Thank
to
you.
It.
I was like, I hope I don't sound too conceited or full of
no,
it.
It is.
I'm glad to hear you say that too.
I totally agree with you, actually, which is, again, nothing against Into the Hollow. I love that album, but this is actually better. Yeah, you've upped your game, which is, whenever you listen to a release that you really like, a good release, and if you're really getting into it, sometimes you think, man, if this musical project can continue down that trajectory, they're going to have some great stuff. And they don't always get there, but you've definitely gone up another level, which is quite nice, I think.
Yeah, thank you.
It's really good to listen to. I think you've selected these singles, these lyric videos that have been coming out. So Ruby Skies, I think, was the most recent one at the time of this conversation, at the time of this video. And then So Long, Portal Hopper came out. I believe there's a third, which I think should be out by the time this video, by the time y'all are watching this.
I can't even see where my hands are, but yeah, you.
Fractals.
Fractals came out at the end of June, so yeah, it should be out. All the streaming platforms. That one's sick. Right. Jaeger does a sick solo.
Three out. Go watch them. Go watch them at home. Show them to your friends. If you're a streamer, stream them. Like, go show them. Go put them on your social media. You can come to Cave Dweller as well, cavedwellermusic.net, and come see him. And you can see him on our Instagram, of course, as well. Segments of them, anyway.
Right.
But I think the release order that you've chosen, it kind of to go from Ruby Skies, which is kind of like, at least for me, like kind of good meat and potatoes, Mothman and the Thunderbirds. And then Portal Hopper, it's a bit more like, it's kind of, I love it because it's got that positive kind of peppy vibe to it. I like that. And then we get Fractals, and it kind of brings us more into what the album's really kind of about. musically. So I think you selected them really well.
Yeah, that's in that order. It's good to hear, because trying to pick singles, especially when like the songs, you know, the changes styles pretty frequently on the track list, it's so hard to pick like what's going to represent the album the best, what's like, you know, the catchiest song. Like it's impossible. So I did, I did have, you know, bug some other people like Yegor and my, you know, Joe Sobieski, like just, hey, help me pick songs for this, because I'm going to be like, if I had to pick, I'm going to pick like six songs, and you can't have six singles. That's insanity.
What's your initial impressions, James?
I was actually talking to Alex about this before you got there. I was saying that it was definitely more adventurous and like took more risks in the prog space than the previous albums. But it does still feel like a lot like, you know, it still sounds like Mothman and Thunderbirds, just going in a slightly different direction. More yeah. I guess the word is elevated, maybe.
Gotcha. Nice. Yeah. No, nice to hear that. You know, echoed what Yari was saying. I don't know. I'm curious to see how, you know, once this is out, July 12th, how people react to this. I don't know. There's obviously a lot going on.
I think they're
going to
like it. I mean, I've been showing it on my stream at twitch.tv/DrYasmin.
You're way better at the talking to the audience than me. It shows that you have more streaming experience.
It's just practice.
Yeah, that's his whole thing.
but every time I show it to my viewers over on Twitch, they you know, all three lyric videos, you know, they love them. I mean, Alex, you came on my stream and you know, you saw their reaction. There were a couple of them, like Aaron Zarin. Shout out to Aaron Zarin, who just started streaming. He's been showing it on his stream too, and his viewers have been enjoying it too. So.
Yeah, shout out to the Planeswalker Society. That was a lot of fun. You have a cool audience, so I appreciated that.
Thank you. I think you've done really well with this album. I think you've done really I appreciate that you have another Flatwoods. You know, Flatwoods is really front and center, which is one of my favorite cryptids.
Oh, so, nice.
Like cryptid / UFO encounter, you know, whatever, you know, it's probably just a bird, but like, but it's a cool story. James, do you know about the Flatwoods monster?
Flatwoods?
Yeah, the Flatwoods monster. You ever heard of that?
No, I don't think so.
So it's this
you
guy.
Tell him, Alex?
I can't do the camera thing good at all.
From the album cover?
Yeah, so the guy from the album cover. That's me badly attempting to shoehorn the album in here, but, Yeah. So yeah, Flatwoods Monster, also a West Virginia cryptid. West Virginia just has a lot of crazy stuff, but
what a forest, right? So it makes sense.
Oh, before we get too deep into that, can you talk about so the artwork was done by somebody called Roving Stars. Can you talk about that a bit more? Can you talk about working with them? Can you talk about how you know, like how you found them? Like just talk about the album art a bit.
Yeah, sure. So I actually found I found Roving Stars just through Instagram. Like, I don't know. Yeah. Instagram's kind of a lot where I found a lot of the artists for like all my previous releases too. So I don't know. I just like her style or their style a lot. Like it's like a lot of kind of like psychedelic looking trippy stuff, but also like I don't know, happy kind of go lucky element to it. So I thought it fit what I was, the music I was writing at the time. I reached out to Roving Stars. I think it was like 2021. I was very ambitious at the time. I was like, hey, I have this album that's going to come out soon. I need some cool artwork. You know, I like centered a couple of the drawings, you know, that they've done previously, and was like, hey, you know, can you do something similar, but maybe put the Flatwoods monster, and then they just delivered like really well and super easy to work with. I think it came out really nice. So. It was a good find, good algorithm luck. Yeah.
What were they like to work with?
You know, just very, very cordial, very, like, it's kind of like how the guitar solos were on this album. I was just like, hey, here's, like, the general idea. If you can run with that, great. If not, you know, I'll give you more specifics. They came back with this, and they were like, you know, do you want, like, the arms holding the words and stuff? So you'll see that on the cover. And I don't know. It was very smooth, very simple. And then, I reached out, you know, I reached out in 2021, and then I was happy to reach out like 3 years later and be like, hey, the album's done now. So thank you for that hard work. I don't know. It was pretty seamless.
I love doing that. If you can find somebody that you trust, you know, when you're commissioning.
We found most of our artists for everything, all our comps through Instagram as well, didn't we? I mean, it's a great place to find artists.
Pretty much, almost all of them.
Yeah.
Almost all of them, almost everybody that's done our art, we found, yeah, we just found on Instagram for the most part.
Yeah. It's an easy way to find artists because it's so image-based. You can kind of just easily look through, like, their portfolio and get a vibe for, like, what their style is. Like, it's also a really good place to find tattoo artists. Like,
there is a culture of promoting artwork on Instagram as well, and of, like, the audience being happy to be promoted artwork too. And I think that's one of the benefits of Instagram, I think, as a platform, is that it's one of the reasons why I still like it. I mean, I don't really like social media platforms too much in general, as you know, like James can attest. But I do like Instagram because there's still a good ethos of like promoting independent stuff and not just artwork. Like that's part of a bit music as well. And so it's pretty easy to find. Like it's pretty easy to find cool artists like music or visual on Instagram. Yeah. I find
my only like complaint about Instagram is I just wish that you could click links. Sucks, though. Yeah, that too. But I wish you could click links. Like it would be so much better if like you could just have a post in the description, click a link to go to like listen to an album or go to listen like every other social media platform.
It has a lot of the limitations of being a meta platform, unfortunately, which means that it really doesn't get enough support, really not enough updates, and it's very simple in functionality. It feels like they just try to play catch up with whatever TikTok does, because you know, people like TikTok more, and for good reason, because TikTok gives you a lot of tools, and but anyway, I'm not here to talk about that.
TikTok. You can actually even shop through their app, which is crazy. They're doing that crazy stuff, and Instagram's like, maybe we should make links clickable. I don't know. Like,
I love TikTok. TikTok has a fantastic algorithm too. Like if you're just a user of TikTok, it has an amazing algorithm. Like if you, especially the more you, if you click, like the more you tell it, if you dislike content, if you click the dislike button on the like button, if you can train your algorithm on TikTok so well. Like I got mine fine-tuned down to like just showing like archaeology stuff and you know, occasional prog stuff and like wrestling. Like pretty much everything that I like, I've got my TikTok algorithm tuned to show me that stuff, and it's amazing. And it's still true.
And also a lot less ads.
Yeah.
Way less ads.
Yeah.
I don't use TikTok at all, so I called it TikTok at all. So
UFOs on the brain, Alex.
Yeah, TikTok, you know? Right. Instagram always kills me because like every time I post about like you know the new song's out, I have to do the every time I have to type out link in bio. I'm just like, goddamn, man, like this is
annoying.
I don't know. It's annoying, and then having to update the link tree every time. It's annoying, and it doesn't have to be. But
when you give people steps to follow. They're almost invariably not going to follow those steps. Maybe right. Like 3% of them will actually follow the steps.
There is like a new thing I saw that's like an AI-based alternative to link in bio where you put in the description like comment for link. And then if someone comments, this AI that you set up automatically sends them a message in their inbox with the link to whatever they want to look at.
Oh, okay. Huh. Like on Reddit where you can set it to... So if you use Reddit as a promotional tool, which a lot of people do, you can set it up so that if you post a thread, anybody that replies, like you can pre-write what your DM is going to be. You can auto DM anybody.
Yeah. The same. Yeah.
Yeah. So anybody that comments in your thread, you can have it to auto send them a DM, and you can choose what's going to be in the DM. So it's kind of like that.
I think it's kind of cool. It's nice. Yeah, they don't have to go all the way your bio and scroll and find the thing and. You know,
just have to interact
with your post basically, which is kind of a win for you as the content creator because it's making people comment on your post.
Hmm.
Yeah, Instagram is the bones of a good platform, of a really good platform, and I think they've got a culture there that's like in the general community there that's good, but they just don't. You know, they don't work on it enough. They don't give us the tools that we really need for it to excel, and the algorithm sucks too. Like you can
it used to be better. You know, honestly, it did.
It's gotten worse over the years. Yeah, way worse. It's gotten noticeably worse too. Yeah,
everyone complains about it. But more importantly, you were midway before through telling me about the cryptid that's on the album cover
of the new album. Flatwoods Monster.
Yes. What is that? What's the story behind that?
I love that. I love the Flatwoods Monster. Do you want to tell it, Alex?
I'll try to. Right. I feel like I should be the pop quiz, but I was basically sort of like, I don't know if it's, people have different accounts. Like it's either an alien or like some kind of robot or something that has appeared in the woods and
little West Virginia town.
Yeah, in the Flatwoods, and it just like, I don't know, just had this eerie presence, like this like foul odor, like choked the air pretty much as it came around, and people I don't know, it's like, I guess kind of similar to Mothman, and then like there's different accountings of it, different sightings, obviously like newspaper clippings and stuff, but it doesn't seem to be like 100% clearly defined, but that kind of makes it cool too, because like you'll see people's different interpretations in the artwork, and like some of them just do it like, you know, all super dark and like I have on the album cover, or some of them do like red eyes, or you know, like a red face and a blue cape or something. So it's pretty cool, pretty kind of, I don't know, like intimidating like some of the other cryptids, but also like a bit of like a mystique going on there too with this designer. So it's pretty,
like it was this, I find it fun because it's just you know, it's cool if you look into it, like just this little town in West Virginia called Flatwoods, and basically I think it was like in the 50s and a couple of kids said they saw a big light. So this one, this is a cryptid that goes around kind of like Mothman. This is a cryptid that goes around in the UFO, the ufology circles a lot as well. And so basically,
why isn't there an X-Files episode about this?
Well, I'll get to that, and I'll tell you why. Right. There's a really obvious. So basically, it was a couple of kids saw a big flash or a boom or something like that. Saw a big flash of light out in the woods, in this little country town, and they ran out into the woods, thinking, you know, like, let's go have a look. And so they brought their parents too. So it wasn't just the kids; they brought their parents and I think some family friends or something like that. So they had a big group when they went out there, and then they basically reported that when they were going towards it, they saw this big 10-foot tall, glowing eyed, caped up thing that, you know, look at the album cover for Portal Hopper and you'll see it. And that's literally like pretty much exactly what it was reported to look like. And so, you know, they ran away, and I think there was actually a shootout at some point. I think they reported it coming to their house, right? And there was a shootout, Alex, I think. And the sheriff went out into the woods, and you know, and then old Flatwoods ghosted them. So, you know. but I think the reason why there's no like X-Files type of episode about the Flatwoods Monster is because my understanding is the Flatwoods Monster is, I think Project Blue Book actually investigated this. So Project Blue Book was a U.S. Air Force project that was basically set up to debunk UFO sightings and cryptids, and not just debunk, but they were actively sent out to disinfo some of these cases that they knew were their explanations were ludicrous. So the, you know, like the swamp gas thing and the light reflecting off that stuff comes from Project Blue Book. So I'm not necessarily saying that the Flatwoods Monster sighting was like oh, it was legit, but it was, because it was in Project Blue Book, it was subject to wide U.S. government sponsored reportage on this particular explanation of it, and the explanation of it was that it was an owl. So
the classic.
Which is like, I mean, I just, call me a bit crazy, but like, I feel that some rednecks living out in the boonies of West Virginia know when they see an owl.
Yeah,
like. Now, there very well could be a prosaic explanation for this, and as you know, as with cryptids, there often is, not always, but you know, but like, come on, a bird, really? Are we really, we're really saying that it's a bird? But then, but because you had the Project Blue Book people, and you had the Air Force, and then they had the media on it, and so, and then everybody for a long time was just, oh, it's the bird. We don't need to talk about Flatwoods anymore. So that's why there's no X-Files episode.
Earlier, Yara, you said that there was a story you wanted me to come back to when you're talking about that evil town. Which story was that?
Wait, oh, we were talking about Satanville, I think.
Satanville, yeah. You said I had a story that was related to that.
Oh, what were we talking about? I can't remember. I know what it is, but
I'm just curious. I wonder which one of my stories it was.
What were we talking about? I can't remember.
Pennsylvania cryptids.
Oh,
and
you have towns. You don't personally. I would love it if you actually personally did, but you don't personally have stories about this. Ah. But you were in Maryland recently because you went to Maryland Death Fest. Maryland, actually, you know, if we're talking about cryptids, Maryland actually has some of one of the big Loch Ness type cryptids is a Maryland cryptid. Chessie, the Chesapeake Bay one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's like Maryland's got a couple of the other big famous Maryland cryptid is the Snallygaster, which is this thing that basically it's kind of like a chupacabra type of thing that steals farm animals, but it also steals children. So yeah, the Snallygaster. That's a Maryland. That's another not as well known as like Chessie, but Maryland has some really cool, interesting cryptids.
And chupacabras. That's one we've got down here in San Diego, at least.
Yeah. Classic Southwest yeah. Cryptid, right?
Mm-hmm.
You had not a cryptid, but you had an interesting encounter with a beast recently, didn't you?
Oh, it was last week. Yeah, like 85%
sure. You should tell that story.
Yeah, my dog and I were being stalked in the mountains by a mountain lion.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. We were like on this trail. I was, yeah. We were on this trail by ourselves, just me and my corgi. And I take him like on mountain trails all the time. But like this, normally there's people there, but whatever this one was, there was no one around. And we were just going up the mountain and he stops like in his tracks. His ears go up, his tail goes up, he doesn't move, he's just like sniffing really aggressively. And then like while he's doing that, I hear something moving up on the ridge above us, like something big, like slowly moving in the bushes. Mm-hmm. And he just starts like he doesn't bark, he doesn't growl, he just starts running like as fast as he can, like pulling me, trying to go down the mountain. And like he's been around coyotes and stuff before, he barks and he growls when there's like, you know, other wildlife. He's barked and growled at coyotes before and stuff, but he was like, no. So I picked him up and I was like walking down. They always say like stay calm, animals can sense fear, like predators can sense fear and stuff. So I was just walking with like him under my arm. And then like I flipped my knife out in the other hand. I had my knife in that hand. And I was like walking down the hill, looking over my shoulder the whole way. And I could hear it like walking along in the bushes and the ridge above us as far as we could go until the ridge ended. And then it stayed there. But we walked back down the trail. I just got back in the car and drove away. I was like, nah, probably not going to walk that trail today.
Hell with that, dude. Wow. Hell with that.
Yeah.
That's a terrifying experience. You got literal lions coming off you, bro.
Yeah. Well, they're bad right now because it's cubbing season. Like they all had kids.
My
wife's friend had her dog killed in her backyard.
That's awful.
Yeah, so they're a lot braver right now than they usually are because they're trying to get food for the cubs or whatever you call them, kittens. So they're going into human spaces.
Damn.
Yeah, I guess habitat encroachment is probably something to do with that, right?
Right.
Yeah, definitely.
Like I know it is with a lot of other animals that hunt, like in Uganda. In Uganda, they have There's a couple of forests where chimpanzees have been attacking humans, which they normally don't do.
Yeah.
But they've been doing it because normally they eat in that region. They eat these monkeys. Part of their diet is they eat these little monkeys called green vervet monkeys. So the chimps hunt the green vervet monkeys. But because of deforestation, people chop down forests and then they build farms. And logging encampments and things like that. the chimps don't have enough, like the green vervet monkeys need those forests to survive, and so their population is dwindling. So the chimps have just been killing humans and eating them instead. And then people go like, why are they doing this? And it's like, well, if you stop, you know, if you let nature exist so that the world doesn't just end up an industrial hellscape like Blade Runner, then
yeah, exactly. Maybe I think the scariest encroachment thing, animal wise, is in India with the leopards, dude. They like literally take people from their beds at night.
Wow.
I've seen video footage of some. There's tons of videos. You just go on YouTube and look like at India leopard attacks. There's heaps of footage. Like they'll literally like sneak into a house and like grab a kid out of the bed and start dragging them out. Like,
that would be terrifying.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, in your case, it's unavoidable because you're just going on mountain trails. You know, that's just that's just a hazard of the area. But like,
just be more careful.
If you got literal leopards, like, I can't imagine that. That would be terrifying.
They're also like they've really adapted to the urban setting. Like they know how to like use like cities as hunting grounds now.
Yeah, coyotes are like that too in America. Like I think I read like early 2010s, like they had made it to all like 48 contiguous states. Like I think the last one was like Delaware, but they actually like kind of thrive in some of these bigger cities in America, which is I don't know, kind of interesting. I mean, you know, maybe it is sad, right, because of the habitat encroachment and, you know, destruction of the environment and all that. But I don't know. Coyotes have kind of been on like the rebound too. Like I think they were really like hunted after in like the early 20th century. And then they've kind of in the latter half just made a huge, huge comeback. So.
Well, also, apparently the other issue is wolves were killed off and wolves were the ones hunting the population down. Oh, so it's a lot of stuff. But like one of the issues is that there's no apex predator around anymore to kill enough coyotes. In some areas.
Yeah, that makes sense, actually.
But we get them around our place. Like, they're everywhere, coyotes. They're around where we live.
We were talking about the Flatwoods monster before, and it occurs to me that you've got two West Virginia cryptids that are, like, a big part of, because Mothman's a West Virginia cryptid too, right? Point Pleasant's in West Virginia.
Point Pleasant, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Point Pleasant.
Yeah, wasn't intentional, but it just kind of worked out for how the albums were. I mean, obviously the debut album, I had to have Mothman on the cover, right? Like, that would I don't know, it would feel out of place, I guess. And then, this one, so like, I guess, you know, as we were saying, you were talking about the Flatwoods monster kind of just disappearing. Like, basically, the concept of this album came for, like, you know how people, like, for cryptids, people say, like, oh, how is this, like, Mothman's not physically possible. Like, nothing on, you know, planet Earth would have, you know, be like a tetrapod with wings on the back. Like, that doesn't make sense. And no insect has ever gotten that big. The explanation people give is, like, well, these are, you know, beings from, like, another planet or another dimension. So they hop through portals to kind of get back in between Earth. So the concept for this album is, you know, the protagonist meets the Flatwoods monster. That's where you got, you know, track three, Flatwoods monster, and learns the secrets of the portal realm and is able to hop through different portals to different worlds where all the, you know, cryptids originate, hence, you know, like the Squonk Kingdom, things like that. And then but the condition for getting access to this high tech portal, you know, magic, whatever it is he can't escape from Flatwoods. So if he wants to return to Earth, he's bound to the woods by the Flatwoods monster's curse. So
that's
track eight, is Escape from Flatwoods, when he has to fight the Flatwoods monster. That's kind of how that all came together. But I was like, you know what, Mothman, like, I did Mothman for the last album. Let's kind of feature another cryptid, and then I have an idea who's going to be on the third album, but I don't know if I can spill too much details yet. But we're working on writing that now. But
I love to hear it.
Well, gotta keep going. Yeah,
that means we can confirm a third album, though, which is great to hear.
Yeah, at some point. I don't want to put a you know, a target on it, but I'm hoping to churn this out faster than I did, you know, the time between Into the Hollow and Portal Hopper.
Yeah. You know, also, I know not to divert back to it too much, but are you aware that that Mothman sightings are still ongoing?
Not really. I mean, so I guess the last big one is, I know people say, like, they can, in like the photos of 9/11, they say, oh, there's an object flying there. And it's like, yeah, it's clearly not Mothman. That is probably just a bird or debris falling. You know, it was a lot going on that day. Pretty tragic. I don't think Mothman was just kind of zooming around as things were blowing up. But
I think a lot of the subsequent ones have been birds, but there have been some recent, recent, the past 2-3 years, Mothman sightings around the Chicago O'Hare Airport. So if you look up those, you should look up those when you get some time. There's some Mothman sightings that have been like consistently a lot of people. I have a blog somewhere, and it's not my blog, I mean, but I have a link to a blog that I can send you later that kind of goes over.
Yeah, that'd be great. Please do. But sorry, go ahead.
I was gonna say, I just noticed we're coming up on time, so if there's anything we want to still cover, like about the album or about the project.
Yeah, I feel like there's a ton I could say, but I don't want to take up too much of the time here. But yeah, I know we talked a lot about the album being Prog. I mean, it definitely falls, you know, if you were to neatly put it, if you don't accept the dream metal genre tag I made up, I think Prog is probably the best place to put it. But that being said, if you're not a Prog head, like, there's still a lot of different genres going on within here. So like liminal space time continuum's kind of like shoegazy with a hard rock chorus. Fractals, which is out now, is on YouTube and everywhere else. Fractals is kind of like a funk bass line with, like, I don't know, lots of, you know, atmospheric stuff and fun synths going on. Escape from Flatwoods is probably the most like traditional Mothman stuff. Like, it could kind of fit with the Into the Hollow stuff, but it's like sludgier, got the kind of almost nu metal chug to it, but it does have like soaring vocals too, so it's kind of a nice middle between Into the Hollow and Portal Hopper. And then Attic, like the last song, and there's Somewhere in Time, there's like a folk song, and then Attic's kind of like an acoustic ballad that I actually wrote back in like high school. So this was like, I don't know, I don't want to do the math, that's scary, but like, what, 15 years ago or something like that. So
Escape from Flatwoods is where it gets a bit heavier too.
Which is
a cool, it's a nice little it's a good track in there as well. Good to break things up a bit, which, you know, I think you've got a good balance of tracks on this album.
And thank you. Yeah,
I think it's a lot more. You've mentioned this to me before, but it the bass is a bit more prominent, I feel. It does bring that out. What do you think, James? Did you notice that?
Bass, yeah, it definitely sits higher in the mix. I'm a big fan. I'm a huge fan of audible bass. So
yeah,
I like it.
Nice. Yeah, so we were talking about this on your stream, so I'm initially, like, you know, I started as a bass player, back in like seventh grade, and not doing the math on that one, but so I started a bass, picked up guitar pretty soon. Vocals are like kind of a new thing for me. Like, I've always done backing vocals and stuff in bands, but never really been a lead singer. So the thought behind the bass was, like, on the debut album, I really just wanted the bass to kind of like support the guitar. I thought that might have been the best. You know, I mixed the debut album myself. I didn't know what I was doing with mixing. I still don't know what I was doing with mixing. So I was like, I can't make the bass too insane. And then I don't know how to, because bass is like one of the hardest, in a metal rock context at least, like one of the hardest things to get right in a mix.
Right.
Once I have my producer, I call him my producer, but, you know, he's like my best friend, best pal, Yegor Lapo. Once I had him come on, starting with the 96 Quite Bitter Beings cover, it kind of just gave me more freedom to like write how I write in my own, you know, voice, my own style. So, you know, being bass is my most comfortable instrument. Like, a lot of these songs started as bass lines, and then I kind of threw everything else on top. And I really just wanted this album to be like, I want to play the bass lines I want to play, and, you know, make them, just make them a prominent part of the song, just kind of, you know, show off a bit, but not too much, but, you know, just have fun with it. And that's kind
good
of
decision.
Ended in this very bass heavy album. So yeah, glad you're enjoying that, the forwardness of the bass this time around.
You have to bring Yego back as well for another solo. Cause, you know, It's fantastic when you're listening to it. It's really well selected for fractals. It's good.
Yeah, he has a he's an insane musician, like light years beyond what I can play. And he actually is finishing up an album, so I'm imagining that'll come out.
Is he involved in what projects is he involved in?
He just has his own solo project. He releases like an album a year, pretty much, like almost like exactly 1 year between albums. So he has like 5 albums out now. He's working on the newest one. It's definitely his best stuff. Like, he's in the same boat as me. Like, he kind of started as like a singer who's like reluctant to do it, but wanted to make his own songs and write all his own stuff. And he's just gotten so much better. And like on this new album, like, he's just doing like, I don't know. It's really like, he does mostly clean singing, but he adds like some like grit to this new album that wasn't there on the previous stuff. And he does high screams. Maybe I'll try to get him to do some of that for like, I don't know, another Mothman album or something. But just have to give him a shout out, because you know, he's been with me through like all this music stuff, and he's a fantastic musician.
While you're doing shout outs, are there any, you know, and if not, that's fine too, are there any like local bands in your area or region that you want to plug? I mean, I know that Philly has a rich heritage. You know, one of my favorite underground rap is like Vinny Paz, is from Philly, and I've been listening to him since I was a kid. You know, but is there any local bands you want to shout out, or just like independent bands, or famous ones too? What do you like from your area?
The Philly's great because it's just got like so much like. It's like when one diversity in both like the sound of bands and like size of bands, like, you know, obviously there's huge guys that come here from here. Like Baroness lives in Philly now. I actually ran into them a couple of times at like the record store near me. So they're, you know, pretty cool. I'm not going to pretend like I know them or anything, but just like in passing, hey, like your music, man. Like they're sweet people.
That's cool.
So, but they don't need my shout out. They're doing pretty well. And they're pretty sick live. If you ever seen, I've seen them like 3 times. They're
I've seen them live. But they were brilliant. I saw them. I saw them open for Metallica once, and they were great. They were great. Great.
Yeah, they're live acts. Yeah, they're so good live. Like the guitar tone and the vocals and all is insane. But and then we've got like Philly has a pretty good shoegaze scene. Like there's a lot of the newer bands. I mean, nothing's like the big name out of shoegaze, but again, another one that doesn't need a shout out because they're crushing it, so they're doing good. But pretty big shoegaze scene, pretty good underground metal scene too. Like there's this band Deva, Daeva, I believe it's spelled. I can't put my finger on what kind of extreme metal it is. Maybe you would just call it extreme metal, but they rip. They're insane. I think. Awesome. I want to say they share band members with Crypt Sermon, who just had that album come out that everyone's like raving about. Crypt Sermon's another Philly local too, so like.
It's from Philly.
Yeah,
I mean, that's awesome. I just saw them live at Maryland. They played at Maryland Death Fest. They were awesome.
Yeah, I'm fact checking myself live. Yeah, Philly, of course. I knew that. Come on, but no, they're. They're pretty sick. I don't know. Philly's it's just always great because, you know, if you go to see like a mid-sized band, like they have like local openers, it's just always, it's always a good time. So I don't know. Philly rocks.
Yara, have you heard the new Crypt Sermon album?
No.
You should check it out. They're Epic Doom, like Candlemass type stuff, but with more edge.
You sent me, you told me about, what was that? What was that one we were talking about recently that was really good? There was a really, really good release. I was telling so many people about it, but I can't. Ulcerate.
That's really good.
We're good. I mean, not really so related, good. But I'm just that just I'm just taking the chance. Basically, if you're watching this, go listen to the new Ulcerate album as well.
Yeah, it's awesome. I liked it a lot more than the last few albums because they really refined like the melodic sound that they've been working on the previous album.
Yeah.
Like they nailed it.
And it's really a pleasure to listen to. But before and after you listen to that, go listen to Portal Hopper by Mothman and the Thunderbirds.
That's right.
Make sure you do listen to it. There's when you see this, when you're sitting there in your jammies watching us, there are three lyric videos that you can watch already. So, and the album officially releases on the 12th of July, right, Alex?
Yeah, 12th of July. There will be a fourth lyric video out on the album release day too, for Polygon or Polywag. I don't know. That was when I was just, when we were talking about deciding singles earlier, that was like on the cutting floor of, I kept it at three to keep things reasonable, but yeah, we decided to have one done for that too. And that too is someone on Instagram suggested me that guy. So he did the lyric videos for that one and Ruby Skies. And then, so my collaborator, Joe Sobieski, another one of my best friends, his brother Kyle actually did the lyric videos for, he killed it for so long. Yeah. And, for Fractals. And that was another situation too, where I was just like, hey, you know, I want something simple and make it like a little trippy. And, and then he came back and he like went above and beyond. So I'm happy to be working with very competent people.
So we're at time here. Well, before we wrap up though, if people want to like keep up to date with the band, follow the band, what social should they be following?
Instagram is just the band name, Mothman and the Thunderbirds. Twitter, I think we're Mothman's T-Birds or something like that. I mean, I think you'll find it if you just search Mothman and the Thunderbirds. Those are the really two best places to follow the band. You know, follow us on Bandcamp. I do have the CD I failed to hold up earlier. I am selling these. They look nicer in person than they do behind the film here.
It does look good.
So I was selling those on Bandcamp, and then I have like, we did a split with World Eaters like 2 years ago. If you're, you know, itching for the more metal days of Mothman and the Thunderbirds, that's like the heaviest stuff I've ever done. So have cassettes of that available too. Follow us on Bandcamp. YouTube is where all the lyric videos will be. And those are the main, I guess, like four.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to do this with us. It's been great chatting with you.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me. This is a lot of fun.
Yeah, anytime. Let's meet up with the next album and discuss some different cryptids.
Yes, definitely. I will do my homework. I'll stop researching Triassic prehistoric creatures and go back to researching cryptids. So I'm so I'm ready for this. But unless you guys want to talk about Tanistrophius and all the weird bizarre creatures.
I'm always happy.
Whatever you want to talk about. I mean, I have an anthropology degree.
Yeah, we both.
Oh, really?
We both have an academic background in that field. So.
Oh, that's sick.
If you want to talk about Barbarophilus, I'm happy to.
A different show.
Some kind of cat? Yeah.
Big, huge cat the size of a rhino with ridiculously. Wow. It was so big that. That climate change meant that there was no longer enough food for it to fuel its giant bulk of a body.
Wow.
Fascinating creature though. Barbara.
Well, you just gave me a Wikipedia rabbit hole. So yeah. Anyway, I'll let us, I'll go do that and let us wrap up.
For everyone watching, thanks for tuning into the series. This is a new series. So if you like it, let us know in the comments. We'd love to hear some feedback.
Thanks for coming.
And Alex, thanks again.
Thank you, and thanks.